Welcome to Vintage SF. I'm Richard Rempel. Today, we're going to talk about Red Tide Rising by D.D. Chapman and Deloris Lehman Tarzan. 1975, this is a debut novel. Both of these, the first one and the second one in the series, the Ace Science Fiction Specials, are debut novels. But the reason that I have both of them here is I want to talk about the blurbs on the backs. I'm finding these blurbs quite misleading. I don't know if that's a problem that you have with books, but it does bother me when a blurb is misleading. I come into a book expecting something, and then I get something very different, or at least not exactly the way they are presenting it. Let's take a look at these blurbs, and I'll explain. If you want to see my full review for From the Legend of Beale by Mary Statton, just look in the playlist for A Science Fiction Specials Series 2. I have that on the main page of my channel page. On the back here, it says, From the Legend of Beale, a strikingly different first novel by a brilliant new writer is just such a work. Is that actually a sentence? It's referring back to the middle blurb about A Science Fiction Specials. This tradition of selecting exceptional works by well-established masters, as well as by talented newcomers to the SF world, is being maintained by a numbered series of novels making their paperback debut. These works, chosen for their high quality, are the classics of the future. And then we get into the blurb, From the Legend of Beale, a strikingly different first novel by a brilliant new writer is just such a work. So, I guess it does make sense. From the Legend of Beale is just such a work. Okay. Just make sure you don't miss that middle section before reading the bottom section. It is the story of a probe team from Earth and its exploration of MC6, the seemingly empty paradisical world dominated by the scattered complexes of geometrical forms and domes of an advanced intelligence. It is, in the end, the story of the growth of consciousness, human and alien. And there you can see some of the geometric shapes. Well, that is part of a framing story for the novel. And I'm not sure that there's really aliens here, more like humans in a different time. No being in this book is identified as an alien. The closest we have is an AI intelligence. So I came into here expecting an exploration story. And we even have the setup in the novel that we're going to be having four different planets that we're going to, and that there was a time schedule that had to be kept. They actually just went to the one planet. Anyways, more of that if you want in the review for this one. So that brings us to today's novel, Red Tide Rising. It's number 2 in the Ace Science Fiction Specials. You can see the number 2 also on the spine. And one of the things I'll show you is that there is word art with the author's last names. Now, these are authors, supposedly, from both the Ace Science Fiction Specials Series 1 and Series 2. Well, if you look at the art, Bradley, Marion Zimmer Bradley, will be the next novel. Brunner, we had in the first series. Le Guin, first series. Zelazny, first series. Russ, first series. Davidson, first series. Goulart, first series. Lafferty, first series. Moorcock, first series. Shaw is actually in both series. Panchin, first series. Silverberg, no. Simak, first series. Dick, first series. Reynolds, not in either series. So we've got Silverberg and Reynolds listed here, but they don't appear in the A Science Fiction Specials, any series, even future series. And the vast majority of these names are from Series 1. Is that misleading? A bit. The middle section, it talks about how the A Science Fiction Specials have brought some classics to the genre. And this I agree with. I think they're accurate in just showing that some of these books came through the A Science Fiction Specials for the first time, at least as paperbacks. So let's get to the description for Red Tide. If a water animal can change into a land animal, Why should not a land animal sometimes change into a water animal? That's a quotation mark. From the book? No. From one of the quotes at the beginning of the book by Charles Kingsley, The Water Babies. Let's continue back on the blurb. That was the goal of the research conducted at Cobb Seamount, an underwater experimental station. Then they received the mysterious red tide broadcast. Something about widespread epidemics, military retaliation, and suddenly there wasn't any surface to return to. Now life in Cobb Seamount was no experiment. It was survival. All right. That last part? Yes, that's a good teaser for this book. We start off at an underwater station that receives this mysterious red tide announcement from the surface. It is a coded announcement of some sort, and the reader is led to believe this is an announcement to immediately cut ties with the surface for whatever reason. War, epidemic, tragedy. The problem is there are no more communications after this. So the underwater station brings down a tower that's on the surface so that they are not identifiable from the surface. There's speculation of biowarfare and nuclear retaliation. Can people survive without returning to the surface? From here, the plot actually moves forward in some unexpected ways. There are other undersea stations around the world that there are some contact with. We find out a little bit about what has happened on the surface. But what of the beginning of this blurb? If a water animal can change into a land animal, why should not a land animal sometimes change into a water animal? It does tie into this, but it certainly isn't the focus of this novel. In fact, the cover of this novel is misleading as well. Besides misleading blurbs, I'm sure you've seen a lot of misleading covers, or covers that just do not relate to the story at all. So between the blurb and this cover image, I'm guessing you might think that we'll have an amphibian man dominating this novel. Not so. But this doesn't mean that it's a bad novel. We also have some humor in the book. We have a Spanish-speaking character who knows English better than he lets on. Instead of asking, "Do you have a headache?" he would ask, "Are you a headache?" There's also some neat little observations within the book. For example, on page 173, Alex had been told long ago by an aggressive friend in Brooklyn, who was on his way to becoming a smart lawyer, that the world was divided into two categories more important than male and female. There were the lifters and the pointers. The lifters did the carrying and pushing and fetching, and the pointers thought about it and pointed out what was to be lifted. This collaboration of authors is interesting. Chapman is actually a zoologist. I think the science in this book comes from him. And most of the writing, perhaps, was done by Deloris, Lehman, Tarzan. That's actually too bad that this is their only book. In fact, it felt like potentially the start of a series. So the prose was easy to read. There were some interesting ideas and thoughts. The plot took some unexpected turns. I enjoyed this novel a lot more than I enjoyed the first novel in the A Science Fiction Special Series 2. It was a pretty good debut novel. Despite the misleading blurb and cover, I would give it 6.5 out of 10. But I'm curious to hear from you. Have you been misled by a cover or by the blurb on a book? How frustrating has that been? Did it hide an inferior book, or was there a good book behind that? I'm curious. Let me know in the comments. Until next time, keep reading.